With calls to defund the police in Canada and the U.S., some activists saying they want to also see a complete overhaul of the justice system. Boz Dreisinger is with the Incarceration Nations Network. This is a group which is calling for the defunding of prisons worldwide. She is our guest this morning. Good to have you with us on your morning.
Thank you for having me.
Let's start by looking at some of the numbers. Canada has around 40,000 people imprisoned right now. The U.S., that number is at 2.3 million. Those are two very large, very different systems. I want to focus in for the purpose of our show on the Canadian system. What would be your first steps in change?
Well, I think it's important to recognize that this is about defunding the prisons and investing in communities, that those two phrases go together. At Incarceration Nations Network, we have made a specific list of 13 immediate demands and 6 deeper, more systemic demands that we want to see happen in order to defund the prisons. And some of these steps are very applicable to Canada. One of them is the immediate release for us in the U.S. of 25% of the prison population via studies that have shown that this can be done safely and immediately. Others include demands around the parole board transparency, also applicable in Canada, and eventually dissolution of the parole board as it's not a viable and fair entity. We talk about parole restrictions, keeping people under the thumb of the criminal justice system through electronic surveillance and unfair parole restrictions that create a revolving door and send people back into prison after they've come out numerous times instead of actually giving them support. And ultimately, we are calling for reinvestment of this funding in reentry services, in restorative justice programs, in education, which keeps people out of prison in the first place, in credible messenger programs and other kinds of peacemaking initiatives that can replace militarized policing in communities, in housing, in jobs.
Interesting point you make about supports for reentry, a video that was just released of Rashad Brooks talking about how difficult it was once you're released from prison to have that reentry of no mentorship support for jobs, nobody to check in with other than somebody from the policing force as you're looking for support to reenter back into society. What changes do you want to see before prison? There's a lot of people who will say prison is the last stop, and there's so many steps before somebody is incarcerated. So where would some of those funds go on the front end?
Well, some of those things I just mentioned, job creation and accessibility to jobs, including banning what we call ban the box. There should not be discrimination against people with experience of the criminal justice system if they are trying to get hired. So creating access to jobs, creating incentive for employers to hire people with criminal justice histories so that they can get back on their feet. We need to invest in housing that is viable. I'm very interested in what Canada is developing around community justice centers that are culturally specific, many of them with an Indigenous focus. So looking at overrepresented groups in the criminal justice system, which exist everywhere, of course, in the U.S., African-Americans and Latinos, in Canada, Indigenous folks and Black Canadians, and thinking about how do we create community justice instead of this militarized punitive justice.
When you look at race in prison population, you see that here in Canada, 30% of prisoners are Indigenous peoples. Indigenous peoples represent 5% of the country's population. 8.6% of prison populations are Black, compared to 3% of the population. So how does the treatment of these communities by police compare to their treatment once they get them into the prison system?
It's all part and parcel of the same systemically racist system. So whether we're talking about Indigenous folks in Canada, Indigenous folks in New Zealand and Australia, the Maori are the most over-incarcerated people in the world, whether we're talking about African Americans in the U.S. or BAME individuals in the UK, every group has its designated other. And that doesn't come out of nowhere. It comes out of a legacy of colonialism and slavery and peoples who have been selected to be the oppressed group. And mass incarceration becomes a way of continuing that system of social oppression. And there have been studies in the U.S. showing that at every single stage of the criminal justice system, not just in terms of arrests, which is, I think, becoming obvious in the current context, but arrests, parole board hearings, sentencing, all of this persists to keep to not only lock up more, quote unquote, others all over the world, but to keep them in prisons longer. And then when they come home, further discriminate against them in what in the U.S. has come to be known as the new Jim Crow. So this is an ongoing legacy of historical disenfranchisement and discrimination. We're also calling for the full re-enfranchisement of individuals involved in the criminal justice system in the U.S. who cannot vote while they're in prison, and in many states, even when they come out of prison. These things have to change.
It is a fascinating discussion, and there is a lot more information on your site, Incarceration Nations Network, if people have questions around safety and other issues on these 13 steps you recommend. Baz Dreisinger, good to have you with us. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you.
Thanks for watching. If you like this, be sure to subscribe here.
And you can check out more Your Morning videos right here.